So the topic today is the surveillance economy and the big business of tracking consumers. We have about an hour. I'd like to leave some time for questions. So I'm going to ask you if there's anything you want to react to or ask about, please note it down and we'll have some time towards the end to come back to you. We have two great panelists here to talk about this topic. Just right next to me is Julie Brill. She's a commissioner of the U.S. Federal Trade Commission, and this is one of her primary issues. I'm not sure how many people know the exact structure of the FTC. There are five commissioners, and four of them are women, which I think is really excellent. I don't know how long that's been true in the history of the country, but that's really it.
It's new for us, and I think we're one of the only agencies that has been.
A strong majority of women.
Yes.
Before the FTC, you were enforcing consumer protection competition laws in Vermont and North Carolina.
Yes.
And you're involved in some of the tobacco cases, among other things.
Yep.
Sitting next to her is Julia Engwin. Julia is an investigative journalist at ProPublica. She arrived there relatively recently and worked at the Wall Street Journal for a long time as a reporter and was on a team that won the 2003 Pulitzer Prize and another team that was a finalist in 2011 for reporting on this issue. There's a series that the Journal did called What They Know that Julia led that focused, I think, a lot of attention on this issue of online privacy in a commercial context in particular. So what happens when you go to a website? And they generated some of the first great data sets about what happens when you visit a website and how many companies are tracking you. And kind of shockingly, in some cases, there are 200 different tracking actions.
If you visit 10 pages of dictionary.com, there are more than 200 tracking
actions
that took place on your computer.
Yeah.
Also, Kevin forgot to note that he was my boss at the time at the Wall Street Journal when I was doing all that work.
Yeah. I actually didn't introduce myself. I'm Julia's former boss, among other things. And I'm editor of Quartz, which is a global business news site. It's a sister site to The Atlantic and is at QZ.com. So we're just going to dive into this question. The focus, there have been a bunch of panels over the last few days that have been focusing on kind of the political intelligence, surveillance, and privacy rights related to that. We're going to focus today primarily on the commercial context for this. And we're just going to dive right into the question. So, Julie, can you help us by saying what you think the state of privacy is in this context today?
So, somewhat perhaps counterintuitively, especially if you've been going to some of the different sessions over the past couple of days, I actually think the state of privacy is improving. So, I feel that now, 1 year post Snowden, 1 year post NSA revelations, the issue around privacy on the commercial side, in terms of what companies are doing and how much they're surveilling consumers, we know a lot more about it now than we did before. And I think the awareness of consumers and the awareness of the public and the awareness of the media has grown tremendously, not just on the government side, but on the commercial side. So, I've been in this space dealing with data brokers and third-party surveillers of consumers for so many years. Like 20 years ago, we brought together a group of data brokers to find out what they're doing and how much they know about consumers. And I remember so well that one of their representatives said, you know, the secret to our business is not so much how much we know, but just making sure that consumers don't know about it. They said that the key for them was dumbing it down.
And so a data broker, just to be clear, is a company that amasses your as much data they can about you.
Maybe right.
You can
explain. So we just did, I mean, just very briefly, we just did a study about data brokers. Data brokers have been around for a very long time. They are behind the scenes companies that are collecting information about consumers, both offline, going to government, you know, town offices and government sources and magazine subscriptions and things like that, but also now much more online information. They're collecting massive amounts of information. So some of the data brokers have 3,000 data points about each consumer in the U.S. that they have information about. And they have information about just about every U.S. consumer. Some of them take a look at 3 billion transactions per month. Yeah. So we're talking about massive amounts of computing, massive amounts of information that get put into profiles about consumers. And I know we'll talk about that some more. But I do think there's a lot more awareness about that, and I think that that's really good. You know, one of the things, though, that I want to say that where I think we have the biggest challenge and why I say things are getting better, but I still think there's a ways to go. We have a lot of great laws in this country dealing with privacy, but they were developed in the 1990s. They were developed when when data kind of flowed in silos. So you had credit reporting agencies, or you had banks, or you had entities that were dealing with children's information in a sort of minor way. And then so we had and you had HIPAA. Health information held by doctors and held by insurance companies and whatnot. So you had these laws developed that were very siloed and said, if you fall into one of these spaces, you had to do a lot more to protect information. But now what we're seeing, especially with big data, especially with the ease of computing and whatnot, is data doesn't recognize these silos anymore. Data is flowing much more freely. There's a lot of health information out there, not just in doctors' offices, but even entities like Target was able to figure out whether its customers were pregnant or not, and developing sensitive health information, which when it became known, kind of became an interesting and troubling issue. So information's flowing outside of these silos. So I think that's the biggest, one of the biggest challenges now is to figure out how do we deal with the information that isn't behaving the way it used to behave back in the 1990s.
And the issue is that if you have certain data points and you can actually put them together now, you know something about an individual, and that has serious privacy implications.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So for instance, just to continue with that Target example, it examined very innocuous transactions, you know, consumers that were buying certain lotions or were buying certain other items that weren't, you know, it wasn't prescription items or anything like that, but the company was able to determine, based on looking at its customers that it knew had babies, was able to determine not only whether a consumer was pregnant, but when her baby was due. So it was very accurate, yeah. And it was based on completely innocuous information. And that mosaic effect, that effect of taking little pieces of information and putting them into a mosaic picture which creates a profile, is very much a part of the big data enterprise that data brokers are involved in, but now more and more individual companies will be involved in.
And we'll talk more about the data brokers in a minute, but the point is that anyone essentially can buy the data about you from the data brokers.
Anyone can buy the data if they want to spend the money, yeah. But also more and more companies on their own will be able to engage in these exercises. And you know, they're going to have to start grappling with this issue of what they're able to discover, whether it's a health condition, whether they determine that maybe they find out that on average African-American women make their best customers and gay men are the ones who complain the most, and are they going to start treating customers differently based on these traits? I mean, there's a lot of questions that companies are going to have to start dealing with, both in the discriminatory space and then also in the
space of impacting consumers. Okay, so we'll come back to some of these things. Overall, you say that the state is actually
I think it's improving.
Partly because of consumer awareness and consumer pressure.
I'm going to disagree.
And I want to bring Julia in.
So, you know, when I'm a technology reporter, I grew up writing about technology, and in 2009, I looked up and I thought, this industry that I wrote about that used to sell machines and software that was shrink-wrapped in a box at a store is now in the business of selling data. And that's when I started writing about privacy. And the thing that is so interesting is that, so I've been doing this now for 5 years, and the things that I wrote about in 2010 as shocking have been completely normalized. And in fact, the threshold for what we consider a privacy-invading technology has increased. So for instance, when I first started writing about online ad tracking, most companies were using cookies, which you can detect. You can see on your machine that somebody has placed a cookie, and then you can see that they're tracking you. Now the industry has moved to fingerprinting, which is undetectable. And so they're using information that your computer transmits automatically to identify your machine. And then they're also doing these techniques to do cross-device identification so that they can use, they can see that, oh, this person has a pattern and that matches the person of the smartphone. And so now they're actually linking the phone and the computer. And so actually I see the opposite, that the level of surveillance is getting much more invasive. Now, you could argue there's more awareness and there's more people trying to combat it, but it's an arms race.
Yes,
and what I'm worried about with this arms race is that I don't have enough arms, right? Mm-hmm. Me, the individual, I'm underfunded. Those companies are Google, Facebook, who are leading the way and actually competing to gather the most information about you. You know, one thing that shocks me about both of them is that they already know so much about me, and yet they also buy data from these offline data brokers about my property records and my car ownership. And I'm like, guys, you follow me every second of the day. Mm. Like, you also need to buy these records about everything the 3 seconds that I'm not online. And so they're in a race to offer their advertisers, really, the most complete picture of me. And so that race has gotten really ratcheted up. And so I am concerned because my ability to detect the tracking is actually diminishing over time.
So, and I agree that it is absolutely an arms race and that consumers are not going to be able to manage this situation. I'm deeply concerned that a lot of the solutions that we talk about, and we'll, I'm sure, talk about some of them in the next hour or so, you know, place all the burden on consumers. And if you can't manage it, you, a technologist, can't manage it, I mean, how can your average consumer possibly cope? So I do think it is absolutely true that we need to instill in companies much more of a sense of responsibility and accountability for what they're doing, with also letting the public know about it, right? It would be one thing if, you know, a company like, we all heard about the Facebook issue over the past weekend, it's one thing if they do that and nobody finds out about it, but once it's found out about, then it becomes a different issue. My response that I think things are improving was really over the last year. I do agree that the amount of surveillance over the past 3-4 years or whatever has just astronomically increased as online computing and as consumers have gone more and more mobile, as connected devices have now started to come online, where, you know, folks are engaged with wearable devices to track their health. Cars are going to have 100 computers in them or more. Appliances are going to be connected. And the amount of information that's going to start flowing about consumers and their ability to understand it and have some control over it is going to decrease. I do agree with you. I'm deeply worried about that.
But why should we care? So I live in this great world where I get free Gmail and I am on Facebook and I see ads that are targeted to me based on the university I attended and other personal information. Google talks about a future where services will anticipate where I might want to stop for lunch based on my location and what I had for lunch a week ago when I was in the same location. Sounds like heaven. What's the downside of all this online privacy?
You know, that is so funny because that's what Mark Zuckerberg said when he introduced the like button. Because, you know, the like button, the Facebook like button is really interesting because it was the beginning of tracking across the internet that it was identified by name, right? Facebook knows your name, whereas the online advertisers actually never knew. They just had a cookie number. And when he introduced it, he actually said, this is going to make the web heaven because the web will suddenly be identified. All your friends will be there offering you recommendations along the way.
Mark Zuckerberg is a brilliant guy.
Right. So I agree with you, Kevin. Like, I am not a Luddite. I want every single good thing that this the information economy can bring me. What I want is to minimize the downside, right? And I think of this like cars. So cars are great. They get me where I want to go. I think most Americans live and die by their cars. They're also super dangerous, right? And the reason we get comfortable getting into a car is two things. One, baseline safety standards, which is all cars have to meet them. And also due process. If something happens, we can sue the car manufacturer for not meeting the standards, and they're probably gonna have to go testify in Congress and cry and say they're sorry and pay millions of dollars, and that's the way it should be, right? I have some accountability. And so we don't have that with the data economy. So Facebook is a perfect example. The baseline safety standard I would say most people would agree that manipulating people's emotions in order to try to make them feel depressed for a week by only showing them negative updates from their friends. So I don't know if everybody knows the study, but basically Facebook was discovered to have conducted unwittingly on all of its members, on 700,000 of them. Half of them saw only positive updates from their friends for a week, and half saw only negative. They had done it through a filter of their own about what they considered positive and negative. Now there's a huge outcry about that. And the truth is that I feel like if I was going to set a baseline safety standard for use of my data, manipulating my emotions to try to make me feel that all my friends were depressed would be something that would be below the line. It would be something I would not say I wanted in my baseline standards. But we don't have any baseline standards. And the crazy thing about our standards is when I joined Facebook, its privacy policy said whatever, whatever. It's changed 6 times. Yeah. And I haven't, my opt-out of that is to quit Facebook, right? So even if I consent to the original terms of this engagement, those terms change, right? So for me, that doesn't meet the standard of a baseline. And then due process. I have no rights. I have literally no rights over my data.
Because in signing the user agreement,
you signed away all your rights. And so,
which he read every line of, I'm sure. He probably did.
I probably did.
You're probably the one person in America who's read every line.
I probably did, but it did me no good.
Yeah.
Because I joined anyways, and then they changed them 6 times.
Yeah.
So, in fact, if one very interesting thing about this emotion manipulation study is it emerged that they actually later added, 4 months after they conducted the study, they added the word research to their privacy policy. It wasn't actually in their use of data for research. This was revealed on Forbes' blog. But anyway, so my feeling is, I want to participate in this economy. I'm ready for Google to give me those lunch recommendations. But they have to agree, because right now, they could literally wake up today and be like, you know what? I think I'm going to sell all this data to North Korea. That's just how I feel today. And they can. That's it. There's no law that says they can.
Well, so just to push back a little bit on some of that, I mean, I agree that we need to have much better rules of the road that govern the way in which data is flowing now. But Facebook is right now under a consent order that the FTC imposed on it, which will apply for 20 years, and is as a result of them making changes to their privacy policy that were retroactive and that were material in terms of how they were using information. So I'm not gonna talk about the current situation, but I am gonna say that there are ways in which current law enforcement can interface. I think that there needs to be more flexibility given to some of those laws, but I think there is some due process built in. It's not enough, but I'm saying that there is some. So I just want to make sure that everybody's aware of that. But I think that one of the reasons why we really need to care about this issue is, big data actually has a tremendous potential to solve some huge societal problems. I mean, you hear...
Like where to eat lunch.
Well, okay, if that's your biggest societal problem, we're doing pretty well.
I'm sorry.
But I mean things like, energy usage, right? I mean, if you think about the potential of the smart grid to figure out, when are consumers using the most energy? When are they not? How can we optimize our grids? I mean, that could have huge impact on for all of us, to all of our benefits, wherever you're having lunch or not having lunch. Education is another area where there are huge potential benefits to big data. Of course, if it isn't done right, then you have a situation like what happened with InBloom, where parents got very upset with where all that information was flowing, and then the whole thing collapsed, which is going to have collateral damage, I think, on the potential benefits for big data in the education sector. And then there's one other, which is health.
Yeah.
I think the health sector is another huge opportunity for big data. So I think the reason why we should care is I don't think any of these potential benefits are going to be realized until we solve the privacy issues. And it's not just me saying that. Many corporate leaders are saying the same thing. They're saying unless we get privacy right, that researchers are going to be inhibited from doing this stuff. The good researchers are going to be inhibited. You'll have bad situations that are going to impact it'll have this sort of negative feedback loop in terms of research, and we're not going to be able to realize the benefits. So I don't disagree. I agree with Julia completely. I think that there's civil liberties issues, and I think that we need to get some greater control over this. But in addition, there are these potential benefits that aren't going to be realized unless we come to terms with some of the privacy issues.
But let me just add something, because I don't know if you can say this as being at the FTC, but I would say that, yes, you have them on Facebook under a consent decree, but you were not able to find them. I mean, this is an agency that is basically, I'll say, has one hand tied behind its back, maybe two, because you can only enforce on deception, right, and sometimes unfairness. So basically, a company, if they never say, this was the Google Street View thing, they never said, we're not going to drive around and collect your Wi-Fi passwords. So therefore, when they did drive around and collect everyone's Wi-Fi passwords, there was no FTC action.
But there were 38 states
correct.
That brought an action against
right.
Google
correct.
Wi-Fi.
But my
as well as the Europeans.
But my point is, are our law enforcement agencies as empowered as they could be? I would suggest maybe not, right? And I don't know if you can suggest that, but I would suggest that. And so similarly, the fining ability, right? You bring them under consent decree, but actually there's no fine until they then violate the consent decree.
As happened with Google with respect to the Safari issue, as you know, and then we imposed a $22.5 million penalty. But it is true.
Which was Google's revenue in 34 minutes?
Or 5 hours of revenue.
Absolutely. Yeah. But we got their attention. We got their attention. I think if you talk to Google about it, you'll see that I think they take us pretty seriously.
Okay, well that's good. Julie, I want to come back to the question of what are the harms. So you said that Google could go and or Facebook or these data brokers could go and sell all of our data to North Korea if they wanted to. Can you focus on some scenarios that are slightly
would you like something a little more realistic? Yes, yeah. I can do that.
Like why should I care that this data about me is floating around? What are the more realistic immediate harms that I should be concerned about?
Basically, I'll do a short and long. So the short answer is that information is power, right? So if you have information about somebody, you have some power over them. And this is true in every sort of negotiation in life, whether it's with your spouse or with a bank or when you're trying to buy a car. And so when people are conducting mass surveillance, they are obtaining information about us that gives them some leverage over us. And so if we haven't fully consented to that, then that can put us in a disadvantage in any type of negotiation, whether it's interpersonal or financial or with the government. And some of those transactions can have very bad consequences, right? So let me give a commercial example and a governmental example. So on the commercial side, we have already seen that companies are really excited about the idea of charging people different prices based on their ability to pay. And this is sort of something that economists could just debate about, because the truth is that there are economists out there who would say it's perfectly reasonable for me to pay $5 less than you because you make tons of money at courts and I make none at my nonprofit or whatever.
I'm rolling my eyes if you can't all see that.
But whatever. My point is, if we both walk into a store, and this is not far-fetched, and there's a facial recognition camera, and that pulls up our data broker file, which has our net income and our disposable income and our number of kids and our recent coffee purchases and how much we paid for those, they can just make an instant price assessment and charge us different prices. And this is not theoretical. This is already happening, not at the facial recognition level, but at the journal, my team did several different studies about price discrimination. And the most revealing one was the one about Staples. Staples currently, to this day, is charging different prices to different people for its office supplies on its website based on your zip code. So they just look at where your computer is sending its information from and make a guess of where you are in the country, and that guess is pretty accurate. And then they charge you a price based on how far you are from their competitor's store. So if you live near an Office Max or an Office Depot, the stapler is $14.29. If you don't live near one, which is I think 15 miles is the threshold or 20 miles, it's $15.27. And this is true on almost every piece of Staples. You go from the tape to the $1,000 safe. The prices are different. And it's not based on shipping, it's just based on competitive competition with Office Max and Office Depot. Now, the thing is, though, that seems sort of logical, and you kind of don't feel like that's too bad, except for the fact that people who live near Office Max and Office Depot are generally whiter and higher income. So essentially what you have is lower income people and minorities being treated with higher prices. And we have now the potential for this to happen at a massive scale. And we have never seen this kind of thing. And I think we have to redefine what do we think is fair. Because we do have some rules about redlining that are very specific to housing and to finance and are based on the idea that redlining actually happens in a neighborhood. But now the red line is going to be like around your head, right? It's like you and me are going to get different prices. It's going to be different, it's harder to detect. Mm-hmm. But I also think it just raises questions of fairness. What do we think is fair in our society? Is it okay for everyone to pay different prices? And are some people going to be really disadvantaged by this?
So can I jump in on this issue before you go to the government surveillance example? Because I completely agree. And one of the things that the data brokers do, you know, those behind the scenes collectors of information. So now we're moving from the individual company issue, which I think is deeply important to the third parties that are collecting information, is in these segments that they create about consumers, where they're taking these 3,000 data points and putting them through this mosaic effect into a profile about consumers, it might be a fairly benign profile that you're in, like, are you a biker enthusiast, or maybe you like gardening. But there are other profiles that you might be put in that are deeply troubling and touch on the same issues that Julia was just talking about. So for instance, there are some, and it doesn't really matter what they're called. What matters is what the marketers and other users of these profiles understand the grouping to be. But they used to be called, I'm just quite sure that now that our report has come out, they're called something different now. Yeah. But what they used to be called a very short time ago were things like ethnic second city struggler, urban scramble or scrambler, oldies but goodies was one, and if you don't know what that is, that means you're elderly and have a propensity to gamble.
What's urban scrambler?
Urban scrambler is just sort of an ethnic person, you know, someone of a certain ethnicity who's scrambling to try to make it. Rural and barely making it was another one. So these are categories that consumers are being put in, and what I worry about is that they might be used for things like payday loans, you know, marketing to consumers who are particularly vulnerable, for products that may or may not actually, that may not benefit them but actually may harm them. And also it's identifying consumers on classifications like race and age. And again, the issues of fairness and discrimination start to come up. And these are issues that I think our agency, as well as others, will start to dive into. As we learn more and more about it, we're going to start diving into it.
One of the categories that really most disturbed me in your report actually was likely to request a chargeback. Mm-hmm. So a credit card chargeback is when you say you didn't make that charge. And it occurred to me that, you know, you might like go to a website, try to buy something, and it would be like, oh, the transaction's not going through, whatever, like technical failure. But in fact, they were like had identified you as most likely to have a chargeback, because some websites just really can't afford. Mm. But when you reach a certain chargeback threshold, actually, your fees go up, and so
they might refuse the transaction.
Right, and so you get into some sort of things that are like, are these things sort of alternative credit scores, which is another question that the FTC has been looking into.
Absolutely.
Because it's really affecting your ability to conduct financial transactions.
Right, like to open a checking account or to open a mobile phone account. I mean, we used those as some examples in our most recent report where these alternative scoring products might be used. And so they're outside. Remember those silos I talked about that were developed in the 1990s or so? They fall outside of those.
So what's the next step, Julie? Like, this is pretty, the urban scrambler is is pretty troubling that they would use that sort of euphemism. So the FTC has looked at it, issued a report.
Right.
What's the path to resolution of this issue?
Well, so I think there's many things that need to be done to try to solve some of these problems. I really don't think there's a silver bullet. I think we need to take a multiplicity of approaches. I call it a tapestry. Because that is what I think is really needed. So with respect to the data brokers, one of the most important findings that we came to in our report was that consumers have no idea this is going on. I mean, consumers have no idea about this collection of information behind the scenes and that they're being profiled and that it's being used for marketing purposes or for risk mitigation purposes. So one of the most important things that I think these data brokers can do and ought to do is to come together, at least the major ones, come together, create a portal, use technology for consumers' benefit for a change, create a portal so consumers can go to one place and see who are the major data brokers, where are they getting information, what can consumers do to look at that information, and can they suppress it? Because actually, on their own, many data brokers do allow consumers to suppress some information.
Because no consumer knows how to find
No consumers know who they are.
Yeah, and who are they? Who are the biggest
ones? Actually, it would be really fun to see if some folks in the audience knew who some of them were. Does anybody know? Any?
Yay! Axiom.
There you go. Axiom is actually the one data broker who has responded to my call. I call this Reclaim Your Name. It's an initiative that I launched about a year ago, and now both the FTC and the White House have actually embraced parts of it, which is totally cool. But Axiom did create its own portal that allows consumers to take a look at their information and to suppress some marketing information and to correct information if they want to. But I think much more needs to happen along those lines. I also think...
Wait, we didn't finish the quiz, did we?
Yeah. Any others?
More quizzes,
yes?
Experian.
Experian.
Yep.
Good.
Intellius.
Yep.
Intellius.
Those are, wow, very educated audience.
You got the top, that's like the top.
Bravo.
Well, there's, you know, Merkel and Meredith, and there's a bunch of others, but no, that's better than any other audience I've ever heard on that. So I do think that we need to have much more transparency and consumer information flowing to consumers and giving consumers some ability to control this. But again, I think that we can't put all the burden on consumers. And so we need to have the data brokers, in my view. This was my a statement that I made most recently. I think the data brokers need to step up to the plate, and they need to do more monitoring of their clients. Mm-hmm. They need to make sure that their clients are not using this information in the kind of ways that we're talking about, potentially discriminatory, potentially deeply troubling. They need to kick the tires of their clients.
Are they subject to any oversight?
Who, the data brokers?
Yeah.
Outside of the Fair Credit Reporting context, when this information is used for marketing purposes or for risk mitigation purposes, there is very little oversight.
And is there any
oversight in the sense of laws that apply, which is why I think we need to have data broker legislation as well.
And is there any model in the red, so to get to the issue that Julia was talking about, the virtual redlining, basically.
Well,
is there any model in the resolution of redlining issues?
Most of the European countries have some law of that would allow that would require commercial data gatherers to give consumers access to see their information and sometimes to suppress it. And we don't even have that, but that would not really necessarily get to the redlining. But even if you could see it, it would make a difference because you would be like, huh, why am I in an urban scrambler?
Right.
Like
the
maybe
transparency right, would make
so transparency would make a difference, but you still might not connect that with the price you're getting somewhere. So that would be a great start, and that's what the FTC has called for.
The sunshine would, we're in complete agreement about that. You know, Louis Brandeis said many, many years ago, Louis Brandeis, by the way, who invented our agency, and also was the father of privacy in the United States by writing some seminal articles almost 100 years ago, he said sunshine is the best disinfectant, and I completely agree with that. We do have laws against discrimination.
Yeah.
I mean, discrimination in employment, discrimination in housing, you know, that's not allowed. But in terms of the context that Julia raised and that I raised, what if you just figure out that, you know, your best customers happen to all fall within a particular category? And that happens to be a category that is defined by race or gender or sexual orientation or all of the above. You know, and you're going to treat them differently either through pricing or whether you're going to, how quickly you'll pick up their phone or whether you let their transaction go through quickly or not. I mean, these are the kinds of issues that I'm not certain that we do have laws that would actually impact that kind of a discriminatory.
And it's also worth pointing out that's not even theoretical. So there is one particular data broker that specializes in giving you a rating for your calls and how quickly you should be allowed to go through when you call a customer service line and whether you're a troublesome customer. And they rank people and you're routed. And so it's not a coincidence that you had to wait an hour and your friend had to wait half an hour. So like this is already like happening. It's just that we don't know it because there's no visibility. I tried to figure out who were the data brokers just so I could see the information they had about me. It took me a month to compile a list of 212 data brokers. Of those, only 92 offered opt-outs, and only 33 said I could see my data. And of those, actually, the opt-outs, many of them made it too difficult to complete. They wanted social security number or credit card number or something I just wasn't willing to give. Or they said they didn't have my information, so I couldn't opt out, or they made it too cumbersome. And similarly, the people who said I could see my data also made it incredibly cumbersome, and I only saw 13 of my files. It's worth pointing out, by the way, my files were completely wacko. So some of them were super accurate, and they knew everything about me, and then some of them were completely inaccurate. There was no middle ground, actually. It was like, actually, I was most, like, there was one group of, there were a bunch of data brokers that basically thought I was an urban scrambler, let's just say. They're like, minority, single mother, you know, no education. And that is...
You have advanced degrees.
And I have an MBA, and I have a husband and a decent income and two kids, and, you know. Then there were others, though, that were just like, they knew that I bought underwear online last week. You know, and I was like, really? they're tracking my online underwear purchases. Well,
and interestingly, going back to your point about how much Google already knows or Facebook already knows, Google thinks I'm a 65-year-old man, and I'm neither of those, just in case you were wondering. And it's because I love sports. I'm a sports fanatic. And so I'm always on ESPN and other sites. And so they think I'm a 65-year-old man. But just to go to the solutions issue for 1 second, you know, if you apply for a loan or apply for a job and your employer or your bank turns you down based on a credit report, you have to be given that information. You have to be told that you've been denied or you've been turned down based on some information in your credit report. You have to actually be told where the credit report comes from. Mm-hmm. And then a consumer can go and look at the credit report and see if the information was accurate. And if it's inaccurate, you can correct it. If you now switch from that model, again, the Fair Credit Reporting model, to the data broker model, where let's say I agree with you that that's absolutely happening now, how quickly consumers can, the phone is picked up or whatnot. But what I'm worried about is, are you able to open up a mobile phone account? Because people are saying, well, you're not who you say you are. It's identity verification, or it's risk mitigation, or it's an aggregate credit score. It's not an individual credit score about you, Kevin, but it's you plus your four neighbors, right? So it's a zip plus four basis of an aggregate score, and you're turned down based on that. You'll never know that that was the information that caused you to be turned down, whether it was for a job or for credit in an aggregate credit score context, or they just decide they don't want to do business with you because you look like you're a risky customer. So I think some of those provisions that we already have, where we've already recognized that when data is used for these sensitive purposes, like can you get a job? Are you going to be able to open a loan? Some of those rules that we already have need to be imported into this new
It sounds so complicated, though, because the number of actors and the range of interactions is big data kind of incarnate, in the sense of your interaction with Staples, where there are probably third parties who have compiled the data. It's hard to be optimistic that this is going to be resolved in some reasonable way.
But I think that it has to, like, accountability is actually always like that, right? So, I mean, wasn't the problem with the GM car, it was a part, and, right? But ultimately, the car manufacturer is responsible for the parts, and then they can sue the part people, and, like, it trickles down, and we do, that's what due process is all about. It's about, you know, the fact that you have the right to challenge it, and then the challenge gets sorted out, and I hate to be like, you know, the voice of the tort lawyers or something, but like that is actually how we have managed to bring accountability into, you know, commercial systems. And so the problem with data is that we don't have that, right? If Google did as they did, one of the stories I did was about at the election with Google, with Obama and Romney, leading up to the election, Google made this weird decision that everyone who searched for Obama then wanted to see Obama news in all their subsequent searches. And so basically, if you searched after Obama, you searched for toothpaste or something, it'd be like toothpaste results, and then there would be three results of like Obama's views on toothpaste, and then down would be the rest of your toothpaste results.
What are his views on toothpaste?
He doesn't have any views on toothpaste, okay, actually. Sure. I never ran that test, but it would be, it literally would say Obama plus toothpaste, and then there would be like section. And then when you did a Romney search, though, their algorithm, their big data machine learning, had learned that people who searched for Romney never wanted to actually see any more Romney news, which, by the way, the election, I think, bore that out as a truth, but it was completely manipulative, right? So people were getting a lot more Obama news than Romney news, and it was in the weeks leading up to the election. And when I talked to them about it, they were like, oh, you know, we trained on this data set, and that's what it showed us, and we never really thought about it. It was inadvertent, and oops, you know. And there was no malintent, I don't think. But the truth is, I was working at the Wall Street Journal at the time. If we had done that, we would have been tarred and feathered. Like, people who read stories about Obama on the front page would then go into the personal journal section, and their fashion news would be like Obama fashion, and like the Romney people wouldn't see that.
It probably would have been the opposite.
right. For the Wall Street Journal audience, maybe it would be the other way around. But, you know, so there's a lack of accountability on the part of the of the actors that they don't take responsibility for the data they present. Whereas in the news business where I'm at, we're like all about the fact that we take accountability for the facts that we present, which is also data, yeah. right? And I think that accountability has to be brought into the system. There are many ways to do that. I'm not an expert on the solutions. I'll leave that to you.
Well, and there have been people who have been thinking deeply about this. Some, you know, Ryan Kahlo was here for the first fest, and he's been one of the leaders calling for consumer data review boards, kind of like what has to happen with respect to health research, that if a company is going to do research around based on consumer data, that it has to go through an independent board, and an independent board needs to think about it. Others have called for algorithmists, that is, someone who sits in a company, whether it's Google or someone else, they sit in a company and they're thinking about what are the ethical, the moral, the discriminatory potential for research projects like the ones that Julia just described or others. And that's really taking accountability as you know, to a great extent, and it would be very helpful. And I support all of that, but I also think companies can just begin to think about this on their own, through their compliance officers, through their chief privacy officers, and frankly, through their throughout their C-suite, they need to begin to think about how they're using data, because they all want to use data. Mm. They all recognize that big data is really very powerful. They need to be thinking about these potential implications and the potential impacts, and more people are calling for that.
More and more consumers are calling for that.
No, and more and more company executives are calling for that. CEOs and general counsels and whatnot, yes.
Yeah, so let's talk about the solution to the resolution of this for a minute. Julia, at the beginning you talked about the sort of baseline bar that needs to be where companies can't do things that fall under the bar, like manipulate the emotions of their users for an extended period of time.
Or at all.
So can you talk through how we get to that point? Is there any path that you see being a
Like one of those people, I'm like, I'm really good with problems. Yes. I'm like, I'm presenting all these problems. But solutions, I don't really know the full answer. But I would say that the Fair Credit Reporting Act has been really successful. It is a pain in the ass to dispute your credit report, but you can do it. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me like a very simple thing would be that any data that's used, it doesn't have to be the actual credit score, for significant decisions that we would have to define. I don't know whether office supplies would meet the criteria, but we might decide that meets the criteria.
Yeah.
But expanding that basically ability to see and challenge the data that's used to make a decision about you seems like a really great starting point to me.
Yeah. We're going to go to questions in just a minute. Julie, I want to ask you, because you wrote this book, Dragnet Nation, and part of it was you immersing yourself in what a consumer can do to live a more anonymous anonymous existence. And I think you were talking about it earlier, but can you spend a minute and just give us your, as a group of consumers,
yes.
your top recommendations for keeping your privacy?
Yeah, absolutely. So As I was writing about all these problems, which I'm a specialist in, I started to worry about how could I protect myself. And so I did a bunch of experiments, and I used encryption tools, and I blocked all sorts of ad tracking, and I tried all sorts of things. And the end result was that I came away with a real learning that the two things were really out of my control. Data brokers just wouldn't let me see my data, opt out. I felt that was really unfair. And my mobile phone, my cell phone, is basically a device that I cannot control the way that I can control a computer. So on a computer, I can install privacy software that actually blocks all traffic in and out of the computer. That is not true in a phone. I can't control what the apps are doing. I can't control whether Apple is taking information off my phone. So I realized that was a very different computing device, and one that's going to usher us into an era where we have less control. But I came away, strangely, with a huge renewed belief in passwords. So I'm a complete password geek now, and I have all sorts of strategies on my website about building better passwords. But one thing I always tell people is that even if you don't care about the NSA or you don't care about Staples giving you different prices, criminal hackers are out there and they are really getting good. And so the one thing you should do is make a really, really strong password for your email account. Because your email account is the one that can be used to reset all your other accounts. Mm-hmm. And so I recommend 40 characters long. I know, it's really terrible, but make it a song lyric and put a few underscores and it'll be fine. Okay? So that's my one tip, okay, if I had great. One tip
Thank
to give you.
That's excellent. So there's a bunch of stuff that we didn't talk about, including diving into the health issue and some things like that. But I want to give our kind audience time to ask some questions. So we have microphones. You just raise your hand. I'd ask you to stand up and actually say your name, and if you have any affiliation that's relevant to this, please.
My name is Peter Orszag. I don't have any affiliation that's relevant
compared to Thank you.
Facebook or Google. I guess I'd like to challenge two things. One is the argument that price discrimination is necessarily this problematic or evil thing. The example you gave, I was troubled by because exactly for the opposite reason that you were. I would be worried about, from a competitive perspective, differential pricing based on local conditions, although that happens with gas stations that are located further away from other gas stations. You, however, said, I'm worried about it because that may be low-income minority people. And I would say, on average, one would suspect, just like with senior citizens discounts that we already have, that if your income is lower, on average, given that there are multiple providers of office supplies, that those folks would be getting lower prices in a price discriminatory world. So what's wrong with that? And if you're so worried about it, why isn't the answer, you can also buy the stapler from Amazon or from anywhere else, and if they're not all doing this, you can get the price, you know, you can get a lower price from the folks who are not discriminating against you. That's one question. Second question is, and again, I have no affiliation with Facebook or Google or anyone else. I'd actually like to stand up and defend what Facebook did, because that's probably an unpopular thing to do. I don't actually view what they did with regard to randomly assigning different feeds any differently than television stations that show advertisements in one market versus another, or Google that shows me randomly different advertisements at one point in the day or another. They're all manipulating me, or trying to manipulate me, to see how I react. And unless we're going to shut down all of that, I guess I'm not entirely sure what it was about what Facebook did that was so inflammatory or different.
So I'm going to take first the price discrimination, and then you guys can fight over the Facebook one.
Yep.
But, you know, in business school, we learned how to set prices. And the truth is that a higher value customer has a larger lifetime value. And so it is very often the case that the rational pricing decision for a rich person is to offer a cheaper price, because over the long term, you expect to get more out of them. And so that's actually a very commonly known metric. And so you often see lower income communities do have higher prices because they have fewer options. It was always the case when I was a cub reporter at the San Francisco Chronicle that if you're really bored and you had nothing better to do, you would go do the classic story, which was the price of milk throughout the city. And you'd go to the poor neighborhoods and it was like $4, and then you'd go to the rich neighborhoods, it was $2, and you'd make a little chart and you'd run your little story, and it was like it was a guaranteed outrage every time. And that's just always been true. I'm worried about it at scale, right? Because the truth was that was known, and people in those communities could then go take the bus to get the cheaper milk if they wanted. And even then, I don't think it was particularly right. But now we're at the point where that could really be automated and mass-produced. And so I just think we need to have a question and a discussion about whether we think that's fair. And we can agree to disagree. You may think it's fair, and I might not think it's fair. But I think we as a society haven't quite grappled that it's coming down the pike.
Well, and can I just jump in on this pricing differential issue? You know, I think one of the biggest concerns from my perspective isn't going to be so much around milk, although I think that that's an issue. And the companies have traditionally, not in the online on scale or at scale situation, but a kind of one-on-one, they'd say, well, we have to have a security guard, or, you know, this neighborhood isn't safe. And so they justify it that way. Let's leave all of that aside. When you're at scale, when you're talking about massive amounts of information, how do we feel if, rather than talking about milk or a stapler, we're talking about a medicine, we're talking about something that people need, and folks start to get priced based upon their health conditions? do they actually need this product to survive? I don't know, whatever it would. That, to me, becomes really troubling. And that's where I think we absolutely need to have these conversations about differential pricing. Now, we did, I think Amazon tried this a couple of years ago, tried some differential pricing, and it became known. You know, it became through crowdsourcing. People said, well, what was your price? What was your price? Oh, my God, they're charging us different prices for the same thing. And Amazon shut that down. So to the extent, again, going back to the transparency point, to the extent that this becomes transparent, and a company still goes ahead and does it, they're going to be able, presumably, to justify it on some basis, and they'll be able to go forward. But when it's happening at scale, but people aren't realizing it, and it's happening in, for conditions or for, with certain for certain reasons that might be really troubling, that's where I think we need to have a much deeper conversation about it.
I think Peter's second question is about Facebook, and your point, I think, is that we're being manipulated all the time by how advertisements and other flows of information are coming at us. So why is Facebook's experiment any different?
I mean, there's a couple reasons why. One is that, you know, experimentation on human subjects usually goes through an IRB board and usually requires consent. And so when it's done by a corporation, it's outside of that process, which we consider to be the ethical way to conduct a study. And so that itself raises issues. And secondarily, you know, the fact that they're manipulating your perception of your friends is really different than what ads you see on TV, because you perceive your newsfeed, and maybe inaccurately, but most people perceive it as what the sort of a true depiction, a newspaper, objective newspaper of what their friends are doing. And if all the good things have been removed secretly and only the bad things left, it's a it's now we're in the realm of a non-objective newspaper. It's Pravda, right? It's the all the news about Russia that's great, you know, and or all the news that's bad. And so then you're in a different world, and that's not what people expect out of Facebook. Now, you might argue those people are naive, and that's fine, because it's true that Facebook always curates your news feed. But this was in a very extreme version of curation.
We'll take another question, maybe back there.
Mickey Edwards, the Aspen Institute. The conversation at one point aimed at Julia was going to get into national security implications, and then it all diverted back here to the commercial part of it. I was just wondering, Julia, if you could comment on what interface, if at all, there is between all this information gathering in the private sector and what ends up with the National Security Agency that we've all become very concerned about.
Right. So there's two, I want to answer your question two ways, which is one is I was actually asked about the harm. And so I was just going to finish that harm question with the fact that the harm the government can do to you is obviously much greater, right? It's, they can put you in jail. They can target you with a drone strike. They can put you on the no-fly list, and you can never, you know, the no-fly list is a particularly egregious one to me, because you are never allowed to see the underlying data that was used to put you on that list, no matter how far you litigate. No one has ever made it, has ever found a court willing to let them see that data. And so you can't challenge it. You can't prove that you're not a terrorist. It's very Kafka-esque, and it really violates a feeling of due process that I think is really central to American democracy. And so that particular piece of it is the extreme of sort of the worst things that can happen with government data. But your question about how government and commercial data is related is an interesting one, because people always ask me, oh, I'm only worried about this one, I only worry about government, I only worry about commercial, but they're very tied together. Certainly the Snowden revelations showed us how often the government shows up at the door of these companies with secret court warrants asking for their data. It also showed us, very shockingly, that the NSA actually had hacked in or planned to hack into the Google data center on the back end. Like, you know, we don't get it through the front door, we're coming in the back, right? And that was very shocking. And the tech companies got really outraged, and they're all, you know, trying to bolster their defenses there, so hopefully that won't happen again. But even without that, the government and commercial data gatherers are very well entwined. A perfect example is your voting records. So to vote in most states, you need to go fill out some amount of personal information. Many states sell that to data brokers, who then compile it with other information about you so that they know you're a Democrat and they know your birth date from the voting records, and then they add your magazine subscriptions and your hunting license. And then sometimes they sell it right back to the government. Law enforcement buys it to look at information about suspects, or politicians buy it to figure out who they should send their campaign mailings to. So it's a very much a cycle that they all feed on the data.
We have another question up front here. Yep.
Hi, Tom Hine. Where do we get your hard-earned list of data brokers?
It's on my website, juliaengwin.com. I have a section called Privacy Tools, and I embedded an Excel spreadsheet of all the 212 data brokers, and I think I identified which ones allowed opt-outs. I have the links to the opt-outs and the ones that let you see your data. It's a huge pain. I think it took me 6 weeks to do all my opt-outs and see my data.
Probably want to drink before you do anything with that list also.
Hi, how are you? I have a very quick question. How much are the profiles? How much are they selling them for, the brokers?
Oh, it's so sad how little your data sells for. Right now, I think Intellius is selling your profile for 95 cents. So it's like your name, your address, your any criminal records, property records, recent addresses. And then it goes up from there. But and the online advertisers who sell your web surfing history, very sad. They sell it for a fraction of a cent.
Yeah.
Great.
We're very cheap.
Another question up here, Connor.
I'm curious about black markets.
Can you stand up, please?
Yeah, I'm curious if you know about black markets and data. You know, we've all heard about people who sell credit cards. You know, lists of stolen credit cards. That's kind of a familiar example. But are there other kinds of black markets and data? You know, hackers who assemble all kinds of private information, even about individuals. And as we regulate this data selling market more, is there a concern that a big chunk of it just goes into a black market? Because how would you prevent that from happening, I guess?
There is a huge black market for personal data. Israel, the guy who ran the population ministry, I believe, or a contractor for the population ministry, stole the entire population database and sold it on the black market. It was really shocking. Yeah, the entire population records. It was everything, everybody's relations, kids, addresses. And yeah, so they did find him, the Israelis. You gotta love them for that. They prosecuted him, et cetera. But yes, the thing that's interesting about all the personal data theft by criminal hackers is that you know, they use it to gain an advantage over you, right? So the way they trick you into installing the malware is they know who you, they look on your LinkedIn or your Facebook, they see who your friends are. So they put that friend's name on the email so it seems legitimate. And if they know the name of the company, they might try to refer to something. And so what I say is that nowadays, hackers are hacking people, not institutions, right? And so the problem is our personal data is out there as basically a tool to allow us to be hacked, which is really unfortunate.
Great. One question back there. We can get a microphone.
Oh, Stuart.
Well, since Peter started abusing the panel, I thought I could say no matter what. So I am struck by the fact that, and I've been trying to translate all of this into the question of, which we've been debating, when should the government tell companies they cannot communicate true facts about people? When should the government suppress speech? And I've kind of heard all these suggestions that, well, if it might cost somebody a job, or you might not do business with them, or it might be more expensive. And I wondered if we could apply those same rules to ProPublica and The Atlantic and The Wall Street Journal. If they publish stories that lead to people losing their jobs, should the government come in and say, no, you can't say stuff like that, because that could have bad implications for honest people, and you might get the facts wrong. Why is it that we can regulate the true speech of data brokers and not the true speech of news media?
So, Stuart, as you well know, in fact, I don't think we're talking about any kind of suppression of speech. And in fact, those cases have been brought in the credit reporting and in other contexts and have not been successful.